Dragons cast a large shadow over the mythologies of the world. Few legendary monsters can compare to these gigantic beasts. But what if dragons cast a slightly smaller shadow? What if some dragons weren't huge monsters, but strange and secretive creatures evolved to live hidden lives in the shadows and margins of the world? The amazing artist and writer Andy Frazer imagines a world where dragons are all around us, from the highest mountains to the deepest forest. Concentrated primarily in the author's homeland of Wales, these smaller dragons, or microdragons as I call them, make up for their reduced size with their incredible diversity and ingenious survival strategies. The author has released many field guides on these tiny wonders that explore their evolution, anatomy, behavior, and habitats in great detail, which you can find linked below. So, for this entry into the archive, I'll assume the role of naturalist and observe some of these creatures out in the field. Now, let's set off into the Welsh countryside and discover the secret biology of microdragons. At the start of the expedition, the first place I look for microdragons is on the low branches of trees. Here, a Draco Nothophthalmus suns themselves in the morning light. While this stunning specimen can fly like a bird, internally, they have several key distinctions that make their anatomy unique. If we examine their skeleton, we'd find dragon bones are denser than a bird's, making them better suited to life on the ground, where most dragon species spend part of their time. In many species, the neural spines along the backbone are also greatly enlarged, forming obvious spikes. In the case of Draco Nothophthalmus, these long spikes can be raised and lowered as a threat display. For the Nothophthalmus survives by trying to appear as dangerous and intimidating as possible, making loud vocalizations and threatening postures as I pass by. From an evolutionary perspective, this approach has been remarkably successful for a dragon that, in reality, is a very timid herbivore. Venturing deeper into the woodland, I find that no two dragons have the same survival strategy. Splashing along the surface of a stream is a brightly colored emerald Saeth. Unlike the Nothophthalmus, this more basal species is covered in fine, wind-resistant fibers. The prehistoric appearance of the emerald Saeth sheds light into the origins of microdragons. The distant ancestor of Welsh dragons, the Dimorphodon macroonyx, branched off from pterosaurs some 190 million years ago. Surviving the mass extinction that wiped out their more famous cousins thanks to their diminutive size and more adaptable nature. Today, modern dragons have branched off into ever more specialized subspecies, with the emerald Saeth a scavenger of fallen seeds and berries. They also have a fondness for playing among the spray of rivers, although there appears to be no practical benefit for this, and is probably done just for fun. Near a patch of wildflowers, a barely audible buzzing draws me closer. Hovering near a carefully chosen flower is the fascinating Draco Cepediana. On delicate green and red wings, Draco Cepediana darts between flowers, feeding on nectar with the aid of their long, thin tongue. This behavior closely mirrors that of hummingbirds, which live a similar high metabolism lifestyle feeding on flower nectar. It might be surprising that such disparate species would converge on the same strategy, but there's evidence to support such an outcome. Hummingbird hawk moths are pollinating insects that independently became so similar to real hummingbirds that the two are often mixed up. And like all species occupying the hummingbird niche, the Draco Cepediana performs a vital role within their local ecosystem, transporting pollen on the long red filaments that trail from their head as they move from flower to flower. Pollinating plants is one thing, but among the branches of holly trees, I find one unusual specialist has taken their connection with the foliage to new extremes. Draco Ilexis is a species whose wings and body have evolved to resemble the leaves of holly trees, making them appear like living plants. As strange as this specimen might seem, there's a long precedent for such camouflage in nature. Defensive mimicry is relatively common in the larger animal kingdom, as mimicking a plant is a good way to get a carnivore to ignore you as a food source. If a Draco Ilexis is spotted, however, they have one last defense. Like the trees they mimic, their wings are covered in tough, thorn-like spikes, which make Draco Ilexis more trouble than they're worth to most predators. Within the foliage of fruit trees, I discover another dragon species makes clever use of plant mimicry. The rotund Draco Acidium looks like a round fruit themselves. Although they may appear dangerous with their protruding fangs, this dragon's large teeth are only used to pierce the tough outer peels of the fruits they feed on. For the Draco Acidium is a frugivore, meaning their diet consists mainly of raw fruits. Many animals engage in frugivorous behavior, and while this may seem like pilfering, many fruit-producing plants benefit from such interaction. Certain frugivores actually assist plants by dispersing their seeds after digesting them, a type of interaction known as mutualism. Which side of the fence the Draco Acidium falls on is unknown, but it's certainly possible these tiny dragons act as natural gardeners of the fruit groves they call home. Being slow and flightless, Draco Acidium also relies on these trees to keep them hidden. Although, as a last resort, they also possess a powerful, acidic bite. Yet other dragons use camouflage for a more sinister purpose. Draco Muscipula possesses one of the most unusual hunting strategies of any dragon. Able to remain absolutely motionless for hours at a time, they hold their wings over their head and release a pungent odor to attract potential prey. Carnivorous plants like Venus flytraps have a similar strategy, using sweet-smelling nectar to lure in unlucky insects. And like a flytrap, once the Draco Muscipula's prey is within reach, the dragon clasps their specialized wings together, stunning their prey before dropping them into the waiting jaws beneath. For this dragon, patience is more than a virtue. Yet not all dragons have evolved to blend in. Although just a few centimeters long, the vivid coloration of species like Draco Favilla mean they can be easily spotted. And that's exactly the point. Like the glaring colors of the poison dart frog, the Draco Favilla's coloration is aposematic, meaning it warns predators the species isn't worth attacking. And while the poison dart frog backs up their aposematic hue with poison, Draco Favilla's color warns of their deadly venom. Delivered by tiny, sharp fang jaws, this dragon's venom is potent enough to incapacitate creatures many times larger than themselves. I'll need to watch where I step. And hidden among the blades of grass, some dragons are even smaller. Just 2 centimeters in length, Draco Coccineus is perhaps the smallest species of dragon on the planet. Indeed, they are so small they stretch our understanding of what a dragon can be. Yet remarkably, there is some precedent for a reptile this size. Nanochameleons are a chameleon subspecies that might be the smallest reptiles on Earth, at roughly the size of a sunflower seed. At sizes like this, the world can be a daunting place to navigate. Luckily, the Draco Coccineus possesses 2 hair-like antennae packed with highly sensitive sense receptors that help them detect potential threats over long distances. And so, this insect-sized dragon does quite well for themselves within their unusual niche. In other regions, some dragons grow larger. Around the curve of a woodland stream, I happen upon a scarcely seen specimen. A Draco Caudatae glistens in the afternoon sun, body poised for a quick dive into the water. The Caudatae is an amphibious hunter, with webbed toes and a rudder-like tail. The unusually long and narrow snout of this dragon contains numerous recurved teeth for latching onto fish. Occupying a niche similar to storks or herons, the Draco Caudatae are natural fishermen. They are also experts at stealthy movement, with their silent nature making them difficult to track. I'm lucky to be able to observe one. Upon the rocky coast, some dragons have become even more specialized aquatic life forms. Perched on a rock in the afternoon sun is the bizarre crimson Cimwch. Possessing a lobster-like tail fluke for paddling under the frothy waves, this organism fills a niche one might not expect a dragon to occupy. The crimson Cimwch hunts in shallow coastal waters, feeding on mollusks and small fish. Behaving like seals or sea lions, they spend a good amount of time out of the water, surveying their territory or just lazing about upon the rocks. On the front of their snouts, they possess curious tentacular appendages that further separate their appearance from the dragons of fairy tales. How such a feature first evolved is a biological mystery. I wonder if I'll find other species with a similar adaptation. Below the surface of the freezing waters, some specimen have given up on land almost entirely. The North Nofiwr are sleek, agile aquatic hunters, using their powerful wings and broad tail for propulsion. Their soft, downy feathers help keep them warm in the cold currents. Feathers on an aquatic animal might seem strange, but penguins possess feathers that are shorter and stiffer than those of most birds, keeping them streamlined in the water. We can guess that the Nofiwr have taken a page from the penguin's book when it comes to their feather structure. Like penguins, the North Nofiwr are ungainly when not in the water, only able to waddle about. In their element, however, these torpedo-like swimmers are something to behold. Further up the coast, seabirds flap above the crashing waves. And hidden among the flock, fearless Seren y Storms dive close to the raging tide. These exceptionally rare dragons can be seen flying high even in the stormiest weather. With such apparent boldness, it would be easy to sentimentalize these dragons as courageous. Yet like seagulls, Seren y Storms are perhaps closer to pests than they are to adventurers, and spend much of their time scavenging the picnic leftovers of tourists. While valiantly stealing discarded food, Seren y Storms often release a call that has been described as a chuckling sound. Considering their surprisingly intelligent nature, it is tempting to think that these little nuisances are laughing at us. Heading inland, I notice that high above the treetops, a flock soars through the open skies. The pale blue Draco Aerilingii are at first difficult to spot against the afternoon sky, but their graceful curved wings and V-shaped tail give them an unmistakable silhouette. These graceful creatures are aerial acrobats, spending much of their time above the canopy, but are able to swoop among the branches in pursuit of insects. Certain woodland raptors are able to perform similar feats of agility, pursuing prey at top speeds through dense forests without hitting trees. But the Draco Aerilingii can best display their swiftness in the open air, where great flocks such as this one bank and dive for no reason beyond their personal enjoyment. Soon, the night will come to the forest. In the fading light, I find hidden among the trunks a primeval dragon that has endured into the modern day. Draco Borealis are a species with a downright prehistoric appearance. Resembling pterosaurs more than any other dragons I've encountered, perhaps the most distinguishing feature of this species is their colorful throat pouch. Iguanas have similar structures under their necks that help with thermoregulation. Yet the pouch of Draco Borealis has a far stranger function, an air reserve. This dragon occasionally dives into lakes to catch fish, and uses their bizarre pouch to extend their lung capacity. The extremes of dragon survival strategies cannot be underestimated. With the sun about to set on the far side of the valley, I come across a particularly old region of the woodland. Here, a heavily built brute with long, curved horns patrols the rotting branches. This is Draco Babirusis, and they have come here for a meal. But it's not the sort of meal one might expect of such a beast. Draco Babirusis is an insectivore, with their diet composed primarily of ants and termites. They use their highly specialized head to dig through rotten bark and leaf litter in search of their crawling food. Their top horns also serve as defensive structures that help Draco Babirusis maintain exclusive rights to their side of the rotting logs. With the sun now almost gone, I'll leave Draco Babirusis to their supper. In time, dusk falls upon the forest. In the low light, I find even more alien-looking dragon species become active. Lighting up the dark are the glowing eyes and tails of Draco Lampyridae. The function of this natural bioluminescence isn't immediately apparent, but we can find some potential clues in the natural world. The biochemical glow of fireflies is thought to serve a number of functions, from scaring off predators to attracting mates. And since these Draco Lampyridae are in a pair, I wonder if the glow they give off is perhaps a method of communication. If this is indeed the case, I don't want to interrupt what seems to be a private conversation. Amongst the ancient and decaying trees of the darkest, most inaccessible depths of the forest, a poorly understood creature is lurking. Draco Johanseni is scarcely recognizable as a dragon at a glance, possessing a mass of highly dexterous tentacles surrounding their mouth. While I've spotted other species with similar appendages, Draco Johanseni takes this adaptation to a new level. Like the snout of a star-nosed mole, these appendages help the species navigate their environment through tactile input, as the Draco Johanseni are partially sightless. Yet unlike the star-nosed mole, this dragon also uses their appendages to ensnare prey. And while details of diet and behavior remain largely unknown, signs of aggression tell me to keep my distance. In the dark woods, I've seen dreamlike specimens and beasts that seem to have wandered from a nightmare. Yet the last dragon I encounter is both at once. Draco Ignisprehendri is an enigmatic omnivore with a striking appearance. They appear to be bioluminescent, with a glowing green liquid dripping from their teeth. Yet Draco Ignisprehendri's light is actually borrowed from their primary food source, glowworms. These tiny larvae give off a subtle green glimmer, and when mixed with Draco Ignisprehendri's saliva, the glimmer becomes a hypnotic light in the dark forest. Like most species I've glimpsed today, Draco Ignisprehendri doesn't fit the traditional myth of the dragon, yet they are, undoubtedly, a mesmerizing lifeform. The dragons we've seen today may be smaller than those of myth and legend, but thanks to their incredible survival strategies, they are no less majestic. And there's so many more species and biological details to discover in the incredible volumes of Andy Frazer. There are even rumors of older dragons that blend into the moss and stone and that grow to colossal sizes, which the author will explore in a new book out later this summer. If you find these creatures as fascinating as I do, please follow and support the artist using the links below, and consider checking out these books for yourself. And as always, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support, and like, subscribe, and hit the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.